The next step is to go to the Thermal Zones tab on the left. Here you will see all of the thermal zones that were assigned to our spaces. Again, we will have to rename some of these that we edited previously when we edited them using FloorSpaceJS. Next, we need to assign some thermostats to these spaces so that they know what temperatures to control to. If you go to My Model, Rule Set Schedules, let's look for our thermostat schedule for cooling. Here, drag and drop into Cooling Thermostat Schedule. Do the same thing for heating. And for our Apparatus Bay, Thermal Zone 101, we just have a freeze protection thermostat set point. To apply this to all of the other zones, you can use the checkboxes. We don't need to apply thermostats to the plenums because we will not be controlling the temperature there. Select the cooling HVAC thermostat. Apply to selected. Do the same thing for the heating. Next, we need to assign ideal air loads. Ideal air loads are used initially for running the energy model without complicating things with HVAC systems. We will come back and add HVAC systems later, but for now, to simplify running the model, we will use ideal air loads. Ideal air loads assume that we have equipment with unlimited capacity to heat and cool the spaces. Let's look at some of the other columns. The air loop name column will be used later on, and it will show thermal zones that have been assigned to an air HVAC system. Zone equipment column is used for local zone equipment, such as an electric heater, located within that particular zone. It does not affect the other zones. We have already looked at the cooling thermostat schedule, heating thermostat schedule. There is also a humidifying and dehumidifying schedules if you have those for your project. And again, there is a multiplier that you can use for your whole building if you wanted to multiply these thermal zones. If you had, for example, two of these particular thermal zones within your project. Next, we can go to the cooling sizing parameters button at the top. The first column is Zone Cooling Design Supply Air Temperature. You may want to edit these based on local comfort standards. I normally do 55. And you can apply these to the other zones. this number is based on your location, climate, and expectations of the public. Next, we'll look at the next column, zone cooling design supply air humidity ratio, zone cooling sizing factor. This is basically a multiplier for airflow. Zone cooling minimum airflow per zone area. Design zone air distribution effectiveness in cooling mode. This is based on the ASHRAE 62.1 ventilation rate procedure. We will just assume overhead air distribution for this. For cooling, overhead air distribution effectiveness is 1 using the ventilation rate procedure. The next column, cooling minimum airflow fraction. And then cooling design airflow method. This is just for designing the maximum airflow for the system. You can select different options. Flow per zone, if it's just for this specific zone. Design day, or design day with limit. If you use design day with limit, it sets the design airflow based on design day, but it also includes minimum airflow per area or minimum airflow rate column. Also, you can hard code the cooling design airflow rate for this zone if you know exactly what it is per the design. And likewise, cooling airflow minimums. Next, let's go to the heating sizing parameters tab. Same thing with this, basically all of the same columns except for heating. This is really high, so we'll change this to 90 degrees. That's more reasonable. Especially for overhead air distribution. Likewise, using the ASHRAE ventilation rate procedure, if we have overhead air distribution, we would probably want to change this to 0.8. for distribution effectiveness. Apply these to the other areas as well. That looks good. Thank you. And please remember to like and subscribe.